Here's a new sculpture of mine. It's kind of fun, colorful, 4 feet in diameter, with sea monsters happily dancing all around. It may be tricky to understand the structure at first glance, so let me explain some of what I see in it. First, some counting. There are 30 monsters, and each has heads on both ends, and 2 smaller appendages you can think of as legs or hands, so there are 60 heads and 60 hands. Let's look at how these parts form a coherent structure. These plastic pieces are white to emphasize the geometry. The head-to-head connections make 10 large equilateral triangles. It's an easy structure to see here in isolation, but you'll have to look to see these triangles in the final sculpture when they're surrounded by their neighbors. At the same time, if you follow the hand-to-hand connections around the sculpture, they make cycles of 5. Seen from the top, this is a regular pentagon. The 30 pieces form 6 pentagons of this sort. Making all these connections everywhere is a fun puzzle. The sinuous necks make you work a bit to see the underlying geometry of simple polygons. Everything weaves in and out, but in the end it closes up nicely so there are no unconnected hands or heads. And I love these 5-way spiral openings. There are 12 of them. Now, let's put the color back in. I created this design in 2006 and made this paper version that's been sitting on my shelf for 10 years waiting for me to get back to it. These parts just connect with little slots. It's rather fragile, and it was amazingly difficult to assemble, but if you want to try to make one, cut out and assemble 30 copies of this template. Then a couple of months ago, I started thinking again about the design and made this small wood model, just a foot in diameter. Focus on the coloring pattern. There are 6 pieces in each of the 5 colors. Pieces of the same color never touch. In fact, each piece touches 4 other pieces at its 4 connection places, 2 mouths and 2 hands. And if you check carefully, you'll see these 4 other pieces are always 1 each in the other 4 colors. The coloring structure derives from this well-known compound of 5 interpenetrating cubes. Count their faces. There are 30 large squares. Opposite faces of a cube are parallel, so parallel planes here are the same color. Similarly, perpendicular planes are the same color. For the sculpture, I positioned 1 sea monster in the plane of each square, and then erased all the squares. Now, if you look at the 5 colors of heads surrounding a 5-sided opening, it turns out that it's a different order for the colors around each opening. There are some interesting ideas here from a branch of mathematics called group theory. First, you may know there are 5 factorial ways you can order 5 things in a row. That's 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, which is 120, because there are 5 choices for the first slot, after which you have 4 choices for the second slot, 3 for the third, 2 for the fourth, and only 1 possibility for the last slot. But if you put 5 items in a cycle, we don't want to count the 5 rotations as each different, so divide that 120 by 5. There are just 24 possible orders for 5 colors in a circle. Another way to see that is to always list a particular color first, say red, then going around from there, there are 4 slots you can fill in with the remaining 4 colors, so 4 factorial possibilities, which is 24. It turns out we can create a map of these 24 possibilities in a lovely way. Each group of numbers here represents a possible cycle. I'm listing color number 1 first, then there are 24 ways to mix up the remaining 4 colors. 2 cycles are connected here with a line if you can swap an adjacent pair to get from one to the other, like changing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to 1, 2, 3, 5, 4. Now if you start anywhere on this map and make an even number of hops, where you land is called an even permutation. The even permutations are half the possible places. The others would be reached with an odd number of hops, the odd permutations. It turns out that of the 24 possible cyclic orderings of 5 colors, the 12 that appear around these 12 openings in the sculpture are just the 12 even permutations of each other. For example, here's the rainbow ordering, red, orange, yellow, green, blue. And here's one that you can get with 2 swaps of adjacent pairs, red, yellow, orange, blue, green. Now, independent of that group theory, there's the question of how to scale it all up to a much larger size. I laser cut each wood monster in 2 parts. 1/2 was as large as I could fit on my laser cutter. They connect by gluing them to a small backing plate, and I engineered special little wings that connect to neighboring plates, creating a central core to keep it all rigid. As a check, I positioned everything together with small black binder clamps. It's great to see how large it'll be and how everything fits together perfectly. This is before the sanding, staining, finishing, assembling, and gluing. When complete, there's a lot to see. Start by finding some of the large triangles made with the head-to-head connections. Then see if you can tell that any two of these triangles are linked, like two links of a chain. Seeing the foot-connected pentagons and how they link is trickier, because you have to follow them all around an equator for a full revolution. Then look for color relationships that derive from the five cubes. Find pieces of the same color in perpendicular planes that derive from adjacent cube faces. If you can focus on just one color at a time as it rotates, that aspect of the structure is easier to see. After all that, I hope you don't object that despite the underlying logic and rationality of the design, I named the sculpture after something unscientific. I call it Champy, named after a mythical creature said to live in Lake Champlain, no doubt a cousin of the Loch Ness Monster. Champy is at the Burr and Burton Academy in Manchester, Vermont. Thank you to everyone there who helped me assemble it.